I'm so glad to be here. This was a good morning so far, and I believe it continues will be a great morning. I have a great message for you. But before I share my message, I just want to welcome all of who are visiting us, all the guests, and we want you to make this church your home. We believe that until you are planted, you're not growing. It's hard to grow if you don't have your roots in. So whatever God is calling you, if you are new to this church, we know there is a room for you, and you can start growing and actually bringing fruit for the glory of God. And also, I have invited so far four people for our Easter services. Who invited at least four people? Who are with me? One person, two, three, okay, four, okay, five. We can do better. We can do better. You know, it's so easy as you go and you, I'm not saying just pass to a complete stranger, because it's hard to just invite complete stranger. We see them, we went to park yesterday, and it's, I don't want to be like one of those people, annoying people, hey, come to service. But if you have spent any time with people, you know, they're providing some kind of service for you, you spend a few minutes with them, it's appropriate to say, hey, do you have a place to celebrate Easter? And if they say no, then you said, come on, celebrate with us. And not only that, we're going to have a morning prayer, a special prayer on Wednesday morning at 6 a.m.
Yeah!
Yes, somebody's excited for 6 a.m. prayer. You know what happens when we show up on Sunday? It's only a result of what's been happening throughout the week. As I sought God, as all the people involved in ministry, as we seek God, as we, you know, prepare messages, get our hearts aligned with God's desire for this service. Same thing on Wednesday morning. We're going to pray. We're going to seek God. We're going to pray for every chair in this room that we people are here on Wednesday, on Sunday morning for Easter morning. They can experience God and His grace. And also, I want us to also keep in prayers our friends, Christians in Cairo, Egypt. As you know, there were several bombings. And one of my friends, he's a missionary there now for several years in Cairo. And he posted something on his social media page yesterday. He said, please pray for us. We don't know what's happening, but there is an explosion next to where we're staying. And this morning, as you know, there were several explosions. People just came to celebrate Palm Sunday. And they didn't do anything wrong, but they were bombed, they were attacked. I think we should cherish the freedoms we have in this country, the freedom to worship God. But we need to take that a step further. We need to know that we bear a responsibility as well. As a result of the freedom that we enjoy, we need to be remembered that God has given us freedom for a reason, so we can bless someone and tell someone about Jesus. Well, let me just ask you first, before I go into my message. How many of you are hooked up on legal television dramas? Like, you're watching any legal television drama. You like to see lawyers in action. You try to learn the court proceedings and all it's interesting and intriguing. It's been very popular in later years. And also, some of the court cases have been widely publicized. Like, how many of you heard about O.J. Simpson, right? There is a movie that we all know the evidence presented there. We all know the glove and whatever else was there. We all know about that. So it's interesting for us to see what's happening in the courtroom. So today's message is called The Trial. And we're going to talk about Stephen. Remember the guy that was appointed as one of the first deacons in the new church? He was appointed to carry out some responsibilities in the church. But before we go into message, let me ask you, how many of you actually have been in a courtroom? Number of you. I have been too. And you know what happens when you go into courtroom? For me, it's a little bit intimidating. Like, you know, there's nothing big, you know, you have a traffic violation, whatever you have, and hopefully it's just nothing serious for you. But once you're in there, nobody's smiling, nobody thinks it's funny. And you read the consequences, you know, 6 months in jail and imprisonment and then fine of $10,000. And all of a sudden you understand that when you are in the middle of the court, of the trial, or even just a hearing, that there is a lot of tiny print that you can be in trouble if something did not go right. Well, I was once there, and I received a speeding ticket. I know, it's really bad. I don't get them anymore. It's been at least 15 years since I had my last one. But this one was funny because the judge was, he sat there and then he looks at me and he looks at my violation and he looks at me and he says, Geo Metro, 70 miles per hour. He said, I don't know, I did not know those things went so fast. I said, yes, Your Honor, they do. So I don't remember the outcome of that, but how many, those of you who know cars, you know, Geo Metro, three cylinder, not very fast car, but somehow I got it to 70 miles per hour. Well, there are many things that happens in a courtroom, and we know for a court proceedings to take place, you need to have a judge and a jury, you need to have your prosecutor, you need to have legal defense, and of course witnesses, and all that needs to be in place. But how many of you also know that the justice before you, the judge before you, also is subject to their own ideas, experiences, prejudices, their own opinions? So when you are appearing before a human judge, you know they're going to be influenced by something else than just by mere facts. And you pray that that judge is not being, you know, slanted by some ideas in his or her head. And we know that overall world's judicial system, it's been stained by injustices, by bribery, by just human error. The main things go into effect when it's people deciding about people, because they're trying to figure out the motives and maybe not always looking just at cold facts. When Stephen, one of the first deacons, he appeared before the court, it didn't look good for him. It didn't look good for him. Because when you have your own prejudices and ideas and cultural upbringing, whatever it is, but then you throw religion into mix, you know the justice might be taking a back seat when there is a religious beliefs and people hold them so dearly. By the way, did you know the most world conflicts because of religion? People can, they're just so upset that someone doesn't believe the way they do. And every time I realize that we live in a free country and we have freedom to express our opinions, to say our beliefs without fear of being of persecution. That's very, very important. In those days in Israel, all criminal and civil cases, they were decided by a council of 23 or 71 religious and community leaders, and it's called Sanhedrin. We know that size of it depended on the size of the community. And they fulfilled the role of a judge and a jury. And what's scary about this is the verdict was carried out immediately. There was no appealing the ruling. There was no 20 years on death row. If you've been found guilty, you know what's going to happen next. You're going to be dead. So I thank God we don't live in those kind of days. But some people live in those kind of systems even today. So we are very blessed to live here. I want to bring your attention to the defendant. We know that the defendant in this case is the man of God. We read about qualifications or characteristics of first deacons, what kind of people they should be. So let's just read the picture Luke paints for us. And what's very important to remember, anytime you just read it, you're reading a scripture, you have to understand that you can't just look at the scripture as historical facts, even though they are true. And a lot of discoveries about the Holy Land and other places have been made just merely based on the Bible. When archaeologists, they went and they discovered something only because Bible describes it to be in there, being so. But as a believer, as a follower of Christ, when you read the gospel or the book of Acts or the Bible, you need to know that there are just facts, but there is spiritual truth in the Bible, in the text you're reading. And you have to be open to receive that. Because a lot of people know the facts about the Bible, but it doesn't change their lives because they just stop there. So this morning, I want us to be open and just to read this story, to dive into the story and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. And I want you to relate to this story to your own life. So it's not just historical facts about some distant things that happened 2,000 years ago. But how can we relate to this? So here's what Luke writes for us. He said, "Now Stephen, a man full of God's grace and power, performed great wonders and signs among the people." This is his description. This is who Stephen was. Now let's read what Luke tells us. How did people see him? When they looked at him, you know that it could be a problematic when you see yourself one way, but you ask your neighbor and they can see you a different way. And it's opposite. That's a problem. And here is what Bible says, how the Sanhedrin saw him. Verse 15, chapter 6 of Acts. "All who were sitting in the Sanhedrin looked intently at Stephen." Looked intently. They were studying him. They were trying to see what's wrong with this guy. "And they saw that his face was like the face of an angel." I believe that Stephen was filled with a special presence of God at that moment. He was on the mission. He was not just there because they brought him before Sanhedrin. It was God's appointed moment and time for him to testify and do something very important. Now, we know that in courtrooms, just besides bringing cold facts and evidence, there is character issues, right? Is this person fit to test a trial? Are they honest? Are they honest? Do they have good morals? Those are the important factors in the case, right? So let's look at Stephen. Who was he? And here is what Luke tells us. He was full of faith and the Holy Spirit. That's important to have. He was full of faith and the Holy Spirit. And then he was full of wisdom and power. Let me just tell you, let me just pause here for a moment. Remember I said we're drawing informational value from this scripture, but also spiritual value. A lot of us have learned to believe that if you are following Christ and you're full of God, you're full of wisdom, you're full of God's power in your life, you will never have to stand trial. You will never have to be wrongly accused and maybe dragged before an ungodly group of people. And they will try to do justice on their own way. I want you to know that if you are a follower of Christ, you will have to face trials and temptation and problem in your life. But it doesn't change the fact that your character has to stay the same no matter where you are. If you are facing an angry mob, it doesn't matter. The Bible says he was full of faith and the Holy Spirit. That's why they saw not this poor little victim who was just like an animal before he was killed. He was full of God and his face shone because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And doesn't matter, the crowd did not intimidate him. I want you to remember, every follower of Christ, that whenever you're facing adversity or maybe you're in a friendly crowd, you represent Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit is in you. And how you look, what you say matters ultimately. Because if people know you are the follower of Christ, it counts for something. And they're looking at you, the Bible says, intently. If you say you are a Christian, if you say your value system is different, people will look intently at you. And what would they see? And my question is this: how did Stephen get what he had? How did he get it? Why was he full of wisdom? Why was he full of the Holy Spirit? I think that there is no question that he was a man of the prayer and he was the man of the Word of God. You cannot possess those things without seeking God, without being in His presence. Do you know that salvation we have has been paid for us and been provided? But the training should be our own effort. The Bible is there. Bible is there. The Word of God is on your phone. It's in your computer. It's on the radio. But unless you listen, unless you memorize, unless you meditate on it, you're not going to have it inside of you. So it's provided. How many of you know that it's not accessibility, but rather accountability that matters in our days? We have access to things and information, but are we accountable enough to stick the course, to stay the course, to be faithful in the things God has trusted us? Let's turn our attention to plaintiffs. Plaintiffs are people who suffer their loss, or maybe they, you know, financial, physical, or any loss. And let's read again a description as according to Luke, what he tells us about these people. This, we're going to read verses 9 through 14, book of Acts, chapter 6. And it starts, opposition arose, however. The word however means that the Bible says he was doing miracles. He was healing people. He was doing good. They, after all, were handing out bread. There's supposed to be no opposition. They're not doing anything wrong. But the Bible says opposition arose, however, from members of the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Jews of Cyrene and Alexandria, as well as the provinces of Cilicia and Asia, who began to argue with Stephen. But they could not stand up against the wisdom the Spirit gave him as he spoke. Then they secretly persuaded some men to say, "We have heard Stephen speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God." So they stirred up the people and the elders and the teachers of the law. They seized Stephen and brought him before the Sanhedrin. They produced false witnesses who testified, "This fellow never stopped speaking against this holy place and against the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs Moses handed down to us." Very interesting. Jesus is not even there anymore. And still, they refer to him. They say he believes in Jesus. Let's look at the plaintiff's character test, character qualifications. It's very important, right? We concluded that it's important in any courtroom. Here is what the Bible says. They were full of anger and jealousy. How many of you know that if people are driven by anger and jealousy, it leads to nothing good, nothing godly? And then they were employing lies and force. They brought him against his own will before Sanhedrin. This tactic, don't like the message, destroy the messenger, is not new. How many of you know that? It's not new. If you cannot win the argument, destroy your opponent. If you cannot win in the debate, destroy their character. Lie about them. Say something negative. I will admit that I do believe that the informational war, it's real war. It's a real spiritual warfare. You know why? Because who controls the information controls their behavior. Because if you always feed on lies, it's not harmless to always listen to lies, because all of a sudden you start to believe them. That's why the Bible says renew your mind by the word of God. Renew your mind constantly, absorbing the word of truth. So then your information would feed your mind and you will do what is right. I think as Christians, we need to understand that whenever we open ourselves to information, we open ourselves to behavior, because we do what we believe. What you're doing today is a result of your belief. Remember, Terry was speaking on strongholds. What happens? What is a stronghold? It's a fortress. It's a camp. It's a base that we allow in our mind for enemy to build. And then we compromise our own position because we allow strongholds, meaning false opinions and beliefs, to rule our life. That's why when you talk to Christian and they say some things and you're like, where did that come from? That's not what the Bible says. That's not how we believe. They allowed this world lie to them, the culture lie to them, and they start believing those lies about their lives. And as a result, they live out their lives like this world. They don't allow the truth of God to penetrate them and control their lives. That's very, very important. So what they do, they bring Stephen and they start just accusing him of things that he didn't even do. But we have to be fair. We have to be fair to Jewish leaders. You know, as a pastor, And not in Connect Church, but as a Christian, I've been to a number of churches, and many of you have been to a number of churches. How many of you can honestly believe that change is easy? It's not. I remember I've been part of church when not the message, nothing else, just a little style was tried to be implemented. And there is a problem. There is a war. We get used to our own traditions and ideas. And there is nothing wrong with tradition as long as it doesn't hinder the Word of God to be preached. As long as the main thing is okay. But when traditions start to encroach on the main message, that's the problem. But we have to give these leaders a little doubt or benefit of the doubt that they were asked to believe in Jesus that they crucified themselves. That's why they were so angry. They thought they were done with him. And now he all reappears. And we know that if there is a war, there are going to be casualties. And in this instance, they had the power. Let's bring our attention now to judge and the jury. The judge and the jury. What does this name remind you of? Caiaphas. Caiaphas. Remember who he was? He was the one who came up with a plot to kill Jesus. He was the one who came with that plot because he wanted Romans to rule against Jesus because he was stirring trouble against Romans. He was going to overthrow the government and install his own. And now Stephen facing the same person, Caiaphas is there and he's high priest still. He's ruling over the Sanhedrin. You know, when the prosecution and judge collude, you don't have good chances in your favor. You don't have good chances in your favor. And what happens as a result of that? If you read accusations against Jesus, if you go back and you read them, just a few chapters later, accusation against Stephen, they're almost like one and the same. They know it worked. They said, he's trying to break our traditions down. He's trying to desecrate the temple. And he's trying to speak against Moses. That was enough. It worked the first time. So they're employing the same tactics the second time. There is no new tricks in this world. And as a believer, I want you to know that any time you try to do something, the opposition would rise up against you. If you are a quiet Christian, if you are an active Christian, if nothing happens around you, enemy will not be bothered at all. If no one around you knows you are a Christian, you're going to be safe and sound. Nothing will happen to you. But as soon as you start to proclaim the good news, it's one thing to know something and one thing to witness something, to testify. The outcome changed. Your testimony can change the outcome. So as soon as you testify about Jesus that you know, the enemy will be stirred up. The opposition will arise. But as a Christian, you know, there is no new tricks in the book. It's always you're not good enough. And maybe you can't do it. Look at yourself. But I want you to believe and know that God is on your side. And all those accusations, they will fall flat because you believe in the one who has all the power. And Sanhedrin maybe had the power at that moment, but we know ultimately it was God's decisions about Jesus. And now let's go over the defense. We know this is the important part. There is accusation, there is evidence, and then the defense. And then the defense. And after defense rest, there is a verdict. So here's what happens. Stephen is his own lawyer. He couldn't afford a lawyer, and he was not offered a public defender. He's his own lawyer. So when high priest Caiaphas says, Stephen, are these accusations true? You know what he does? He delivers the sermon. He uses this opportunity to deliver the sermon. He doesn't say yay or nay. He says, let me tell you about my God. And he delivers a message. This is the longest written sermon in the book of Acts. The longest. This is twice as long as Peter's message at the day of Pentecost. It's 52 verses long and it takes 8 minutes 30 seconds for average reader. This is the longest one. We know there were some long ones when Paul spoke. Remember, people fell asleep. And one guy fell off of the balcony of the window sill. He fell and he was almost dead, and then Paul raised him. So we know there were long messages, but this is the longest written message. But if you think you were subjected to long messages when you were growing up, I remember those days when there are five preachers and everyone has a lot to say. Zach Zander, a pastor from Florida, he actually wanted to be in a book of records, a Guinness Book of Records, and he prepared a message that lasted 53 hours and 18 minutes. How about that for a message? The message started on Friday night and it ended Sunday afternoon. And he used 200 pages of notes and 600 PowerPoint slides. That's a message. And he preached from Genesis to Revelation, of course. And congregation, they would switch and come and listen to him and listen again. So they were very blessed. So we missed a good message right there. Now, Stephen, what he starts with, he repudiates. He just denounced any accusation against him. Because now he was accused in blasphemy against God. And he was accused of speaking against two most sacred things for the Jews, except God. It's the temple and the law. Those are nothing else. You cannot do anything worse than speak against God or against temple or the law. And Stephen was accused of that. So you know what he does? He's his own lawyer. So he calls first witness to the stand. And you know who he calls on stand? Stephen puts God on trial. He calls them on stand. For me, as I was reading this message, I was preparing this message, I realized that it makes a difference who is your witness. It makes a difference. Whenever you try being tried by circumstances, by life, by world, by people, where do you go for immediate relief? Where do you go? Do you start blaming God? God, why does it happen to me always? It's only me. If only I was surrounded by better people. You know what Stephen does? He says, God, why don't you testify on my behalf? It says, God, I know you are faithful. God, I know your promises are true. You know, when you call your child and you say, why did you do that or that? I know how those conversations end, right? I don't know. So in other words, you're saying to your children, I already told you about this. You knew the consequences. You knew what's going to happen. You knew what's expected of you. And yet, you did not do it. Why? The usual answer, I don't know. I find this very interesting. Stephen calls God on stand. You know why? Because his message starts from Abraham, Father Abraham, and all of them believed in Abraham. And then he says, God promised Abraham a son, and he gave him a son. God promised Moses will take people out of captivity and lead them to freedom, to promised land. And it happened. And then he spends a lot of time on Joseph. And Joseph and Moses, did you know they were in likeness of Christ? They were shadows of Christ. They were telling about coming of the Messiah. And Stephen spends a lot of time there. So what he does, in fact, he puts God on trial. He says, do you know God promised this and he delivered? God said this and he delivered. In other words, he says, whatever God says is true. He's faithful God. And what does Sanhedrin has to do now? They don't have a choice but to vindicate God because God is blameless. He says and he delivers. He promises and he does it. And you know what happens next? Before we go there, I want you to know that even if you write, it does not mean you will not be accused. Even if you write, you will not be accused. But here's what I want to call you to do. I want you to put God on trial in the presence of your enemies. Don't stand up for yourself with your own power, with your own record. Start recounting. Start telling God's mercies and God's promises and God's faithfulness. Whenever you face with a trial in your life, with temptation, with some kind of adversity, start remembering what God has done for you, what he promised and what he delivered, how he said he would love you and have mercy on you, and how he did that. And as you remember, as you recount, as you tell that story, your faith will grow. You will know that God will not fail you even in this situation. And then what happens next? He tells them about God, who God is. And I find chapter 51 of prophet Isaiah is just full of such great promises of God. This chapter is just tells about faithfulness and salvation that comes only from God. I want to read this chapter to you, this few verses. I want you to read the whole chapter at home. And I find these promises to be very uplifting. Whatever you may be going through today, I want you to read this chapter. I want you to read, because Stephen quoted them, Psalm 26 and 3. He says, God is great. God is merciful. And here's what prophet Isaiah says in 51, the first chapter. I'm going to read a few verses. He said, listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. You know, the word of God always directed to those who believe in it. God is not trying to persuade some people who couldn't care less about him. God says, you who believe, listen, be my witnesses on my behalf. Listen to my word. And he said, look to the rock from which you were cut and the quarry from which you were hewn. Not the word I use every day. In other words, I find this to be very interesting. God calls us to look. Again, when God calls us to look somewhere or to remember something, as a rule, he doesn't call us so we can look at ourselves and feel bad. So we don't look at ourselves and feel discouraged. Usually when God says look, he wants you to look at his faithfulness. He wants you to look at his promises. He wants you to look at his mercies and love for you. And here he says, look at the rock from which you were cut. How many of you know that even a diamond, until it's been polished, it doesn't look like anything. It doesn't have value. And God says, look at the rock from which I cut you. You were just a piece of rock. You were part of something not valuable, but I saw something in you and I cut you out. I put you in your position right now. Look at it and think about where I lifted you up. Look at it. And then God says, my righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way, and my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. Those are not good words. Those are not very, very uplifting things. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail. Hear me, you who know what is right. You people who have taken my instruction to heart. Here is the word for you. Do not fear the reproach of mere mortals or be terrified by their insults. Whatever you're facing today, I want you to know, you don't have to be afraid of the insults that's being spoken against you, of different things that's standing up against you. For I am the Lord your God who stirs up the sea and that its waves roar. The Lord Almighty is my name. I have put my words in your mouth and covered you with the shadow of my hand. I who set the heavens in place, who lay the foundation of the earth, and who says to Zion, you are my people. And then he goes on in chapter 51. I want you to read the whole chapter. It's full of blessings and full of promises of God's faithfulness. And now, Stephen calls the second witness to the stand. And you know what he does? He puts people of Israel on trial. He put God on trial, and they had to acknowledge that God is faithful. God is just. God is right. And then he puts people of Israel on trial. It says, God has spoken to you through many prophets, but you killed them all and you rejected Christ. And then he says, you stiff-necked people. You know, when I read this, I think he wasn't afraid. And how is that for an opening argument? You stiff-necked people. And he knows they have power over him right at the moment. Here's what he says. Your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors. And you know what, uncircumcised, he says, you're just like Gentiles who don't know God. It was very insulting. They didn't like that at all. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestor did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one, and they know he means Jesus. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it. Those are pretty harsh words, won't you agree? There was no political correctness. There was no slow start. He gets right to the point. He lets them have it. At this moment, he knows that his life is not in their hands. And his responsibility is to deliver the message of truth. He does not leave interpretation of his message to his listeners. He just speaks the truth. He tells them what he thinks. He gives them the application. And he says, if God is righteous and true and faithful, then you are not. He says, if God has promised and it came to pass, you did not listen to him. And here's what happens. You know what happens afterwards? The verdict. The verdict. In this case, we have to realize that Luke never tells us the actual, the passing of the word verdict. He doesn't say, and then they had little counsel and they cast him out and they had some time behind closed doors and they came up with a verdict to kill him. No, the Bible doesn't tell us that. That's why I'm so happy we don't live in those days. The Bible says, while they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. They just all collectively decided he's not fit to live, to be alive. And they just rose up and they stoned him to death. Here is where it gets very important to know, that before he died, Stephen told them that I see Jesus standing at the right hand of God. He knew that even though he did not have human defense, he knew Jesus was defending him. He was standing in a courtroom. So as God is still on the throne and Jesus is fighting on your behalf. He has all the power. And here is what happened. They thought they had verdict over him. Here's what happened. Remember, the Bible says, and when they were stoning Stephen, they put their clothes at the feet of a person named, what was his name? Saul. You know what happened at that moment? If we read the book of Acts, we know that what's written here is very, very important for us to understand, that it's written for us as an instruction. And after this event, there is no gospel being preached in the streets of Jerusalem. Then the gospel goes to Samaria and goes on and on. So the verdict was, the gospel now will be preached to the Gentiles. Stephen did not have an altar call for that crowd. Anytime in the gospel we read in the book of Acts, there is a preaching of the gospel, and then they say, so what do we do? And they say, repent, come to salvation, come to Christ. When we read this message, Stephen never gives the altar call because God has passed his verdict. He said, if you're rejecting the gospel, it will be taken from you. Now it's going to go to Gentiles. It will be preached to Gentiles. Your time is over. And even until these days, Israel does not receive Jesus as their Savior. Only some people. You know, when God passes a verdict, it's final. God has a plan. Of course, God always has a plan. But far as us concerned, if God is speaking to us today, we need to know that it's in his hands, our life. And Stephen knew that. That's why he wasn't afraid. Remember, today is Palm Sunday. How many of you know today's Palm Sunday? And like I said, Christians in Cairo, they came to celebrate Palm Sunday. And they were attacked. When Jesus was approaching Jerusalem, and he saw people of Jerusalem being scattered. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, even if this day you will recognize who is among you, If you will recognize me, I came to save you, to rescue you. But because you reject me, and they crucified him, he said, your house will be left empty and desolate. They thought they're passing verdict on Jesus when they crucified him. And you know what in fact happened? I just realized what happened. When Jesus was crucified, it was God who was the one who was passing the verdict. And the verdict was not on Jesus. The verdict was on sin. So the sin was crucified in Jesus so we can receive freedom in Christ. And now as a child of God, you must know that there is no power in this world to pass the verdict against your life because you're in Christ. And if you are in Christ, you're freed of any condemnation, of any judgment. He is the only one who can pass a verdict. And he already did that. You accepted, you're beloved, you belong to him. And Bible says, as a result of that, you don't have to live in fear. You don't have to live in fear. You're never going to learn how to ride your bike until you're afraid. You're never going to live to the fullest until you realize that your life is hidden in Christ and you have nothing to be afraid. There is no enemy. There is no demon and Satan in the world who can stand against you and be successful because the verdict was passed for your life and you are free in Christ and saved. Your life is hidden in Christ Jesus. So what Stephen said to them was very important. He said, I see Jesus standing and I see God on the throne. As long as we believe those two things, Jesus standing for our defense if you're in Christ and God is still on throne, there is nothing to be afraid in this world. People think they're made, got you, they cornered you, but God has your back and God has a way. So today I will invite the worship team to come up here and I want us to pray. I want us to pray a special prayer this morning. And I want you to be very, very aware of the situations you are facing. Remember I said that it's important for a Christian to realize that we live in physical reality, but we also live in spiritual reality. And the things that stand against you, you have to recognize that the spiritual world is behind what you're facing right now. And if you have the right discernment, you will be victorious. You will not be depressed. You will not be hopeless because you know in the midst of your trial, God is enthroned and Jesus standing up in your defense. So the outcome will be up to God, not to people. But we need to live without fear because God has us in his hands. And what can we learn from Stephen? We can learn that if you feel like you're being treated unfair, unjustly, maybe you're standing against insurmountable circumstances, God says, I have your back. I know what's ahead of you. I have your future all mapped out. I know what's going to happen. Just trust me. Don't think your life is over. But the Bible says there is price for victory. Christ pays for us. But if you want to live in victory, you need to dwell in the Word of God. You need to seek God in prayer. Not to gain the victory, but to live in victory, you need to exercise in it. Exercise in it. Proclaim it over your life. So right now, if you would please stand. We're going to pray, and then as we go into worship, I want every one of you who are facing any kind of trial, any battle right now, I want you to know, and I want you to come to the front. We'll pray with you, and I will ask leaders to come here. I want you to recognize the trouble you've been facing, the pressure you've been facing. It's spiritual. There is something behind those spirits. They want you to live in fear, in sense of just absolute dead end, that there is no exit, there is no way for you, but I want you to know that God is still on the throne and Christ is standing up for your defense. The verdict has been passed. You are the child of God. You are hidden in Christ and nothing will harm you. So if enemy been standing against you, it seems like your life's been maybe all long trial. I want you to know that you don't have to be afraid. Let's pray right now. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for freedom you gave us in Christ. Father, thank you so much that your promises are true. And whenever we put you on trial, you always come victorious. Your promises are true. Your word is true. Your love for us is permanent and unceasing. Lord, I pray that this church we'll be strong and courageous in our faith. Lord, that we know how to stand up for ourselves, not because we're so good, but because you are good. And whenever we recall, whenever we remember what you have done for us, may faith arise and our conviction and our just strong beliefs that you are with us, that you have what it takes to see us through. Lord, I pray that we are people who live by faith, not by what we see, not by what people say, not by what the circumstances say, but whatever you say about us, Lord. Thank you that your verdict has been passed and you say, you are my child and nothing and no one will take it from me, Lord. Holy Spirit, I pray that you heal hearts today, heal minds today, Lord, so we will be released from fear, and we denounce every fear, every accusation directed towards us, Lord, and we choose to believe you, to stay in faith, to stay committed to you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Right now, as we go into worship, I want you to be proactive and recognize the problems you may be facing. Recognize the fear you're going through and know that it's directed towards you to keep you down, to keep you against from speaking. Let's just go into worship. And this is your time.
Is enough for me. Everything I need is in
church,
you.
I know that this is your time right now.
Everything
I want you to be proactive. And if something is standing up against you, just make your way up here. We're going to pray with you. It's time for us to recognize that God has given us his freedom. And we are called to free life. Life free of fear. Over any condemnation in our lives. So this is our time to proclaim freedom in the name of Jesus.
Everything I need, I've decided to follow Jesus.
So whatever you're facing, whatever you're facing today, it's your time to proclaim freedom because the verdict was passed. I want you to, today, before everyone, just proclaim that you trust that Jesus is standing up for you, and you refuse to live in fear and condemnation in the name of Jesus.
To follow Jesus, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back.
Father God, we worship you. Father God, we worship you. And this morning, Lord, we recognize that the enemy wants to hold us down in fear, in hopelessness. Father, we proclaim with our voices filled with faith and trust in you, Lord, that we are your people. And because we trust in you, you will not fail us, Lord. I want you to lift your hands right now. And whatever you're facing, just speak life over your situation. Speak life in the name of Jesus. Because when you put God on trial, he always comes victorious. Whenever you're faced with an impossible situation, proclaim God and ask him to go before you, because he never failed anyone and his promises are true. Father God, thank you that coming to Easter, Lord, we know that we can trust you, that we can depend on you, Lord, and we want to share this message with so many people, Lord. I pray that you use every one of us to become instrumental in your hands, inviting, loving, praying for, and bringing people to salvation. In the name of Jesus, we pray. In the name of Jesus.